This week, income tax made simple. Normie Rowe ventures where few of us dare to go. And we also turn recycled trash into home renovators' treasure. Hi, welcome to Bricks and Mortar. Stay with us for details on how you can win a fantastic dream home valued at $215,000. Also, make those repairs easier with wood products. And meet our new expert who seeks out the latest labour-saving gadgets and inventions. John Stower shows us trees to colour your winter. But first, the good old brick has some inherent problems of which you should be aware. Here's Bob.
I have a letter from LF of Mona Vale, New South Wales. Among other things, he writes, "We purchased a property in 1987. In the last year or so, we've become aware of the rapidly accelerating loss of face of many of the bricks, some losing as much as 4 to 5 millimetres. The brick company said it was a general purpose brick and unsuitable for our location. I'd like your opinion." Well, as you can see, the house is situated in a very exposed position. The wind comes straight in from the sea over here and beats against the house, and the wind brings with it the salt spray, which is thought to be causing this sort of erosion. And this is just a small example of what's going on all over the house. But that's just my opinion from my limited knowledge. Let's call in the experts. Max, this looks like a classical example of either salt spray or under firing. What do you think?
Yes, it's both, Bob, a combination of the two. The salt spray is deposited on the wall surface in very fine crystals of salt. When it rains, that salt is turned into solution and absorbed by the bricks and mortar and grows as tiny crystals of salt inside the brick, just a couple of millimetres under the surface. And as those crystals grow, they cause the surface of the brick to spall off.
Max, the other thing that bothers me is, if it's the salt that's fretting the bricks, why isn't it fretting the mortar?
Well, in fact, it has, Bob, in some areas. Down here you can see that there is a beginning of attack on the mortar joints here, although it has been ironed as an iron joint. You can see the tooling has been lost in this area from the salt attacking the mortar. So it's important in a saline environment both to have an exposure grade brick and a good quality mortar.
I see. That would account also then for the joints between the tiles here on this windowsill.
Yes, it's true. Under windows, the area of glass collects the salt, and that is washed down and has been concentrated on those points between the tiles, and you can see much greater erosion of the mortar due to salt attack there.
Well, that all sounds pretty straightforward, but I still have some doubts. I'm going to take a couple of these bricks and do a bit more investigating. I'll be back later in the program.
Winter is the season of the year when the bones of a garden are revealed. You see the form, the shape of plants, and in particular, the structure of the trunk and the limbs. And our Australian eucalypts have to be one of the best groups of plants in the whole world for interesting form and bark, colours and textures. If you live in the drier parts of Australia, you are able to grow the malleiform eucalypts. But if you haven't got those at your disposal, plant any sort of eucalypt closely together, putting 3 or 4 plants in the one planting hole. And that way you'll get wonderful, interesting shapes as they develop. Angophoras are renowned for their gnarled and twisted limb structure. They're butte trees under the toughest of conditions. And the Australian rainforest brush box, with its smooth pink limbs and trunk, is great contrast to the stringy barks, with its fibrousy rough texture. As a summer flowering tree, the crepe myrtle, Lagerstromia indica, is really fabulous. But you only have those flowers for a few weeks of the year. The rest of the year, you have this fantastic mottled bark. and that will be achieved on any tree at all. But let the tree adopt its natural form. Don't hack it back, as so is commonly seen. This particular one has been pruned back very hard at that level in years past, and then obviously it's been pruned again at that level, and you get this most unsatisfactory appearance. If you let it adopt its natural form, you'll be much more pleased with the results. And if you don't have one that's been destroyed, you can then train it very gently by thinning out the branches, as we'll see in another site. And this crepe myrtle has the potential to be a superb specimen because it's centrally placed in a lawn. And in the past, it has not been hacked back to a stump. It's a real beauty. All it needs is an overall trim of branches that have been damaged or have died back, and then an opening up of the centre. So I'm going to start off with this broken limb here, which is only inviting trouble. And then dead stubs, such as this one here, which will never grow out again, they have to be taken back to what we call the collar. That growth there is obviously needing removing because there is no sign of life in it at all. In fact, a lot of people use as a general principle removal of anything that's heading in towards the centre of the plant, only allowing the outward facing growth to remain. Well, having removed all damaged limbs and stubs that have died, the only thing remaining is to open up the centre of the plant. And I can do that by removing just one substantial limb.
I'm looking forward to the second part. Next, details on our wonderful Dream Home giveaway, ways to make wood products work for you, and easing the pain of income tax. The new Bricks and Mortar with New Steel Homes and the Australian Women's Weekly is giving you the chance to win your dream home by the sea. On a prime block at Sunshine Bay on the glorious New South Wales south coast, your New Steel home will be built with quality Australian products. To enter, fill out the coupon in the Australian Women's Weekly and mail it to Win a House Contest, Australian Women's Weekly, Post Office Box 7052, GPO Sydney, New South Wales 2001. Or post the coupon free from any New Steel office or display home anywhere in Australia. And keep watching the new Bricks and Mortar for the key words to win an extra $30,000 worth of landscaping and accessories. A $215,000 house and land package, compliments of the Australian Women's Weekly, New Steel Homes, and the new Bricks and Mortar. If you haven't already posted your entry form, don't delay. Later on, we give you a chance to pick up those keywords and win those $30,000 worth of extras. Tax time's a headache for most of us each year. A few tips on how to cope coming up, but in the meantime, let's explore wood products with Bob Ryan.
Man-made boards save a lot of our natural resources because we use chips and flakes and fibres. Everybody probably remembers masonite. Be very few of us who don't know about that. But there are lots of different man-made boards now. All these, for example, they all have their different uses. Right now, I'm going to make a shadow board with pegboard. And this is it. You can buy standard sizes from the hardware store if you've got a lot of tools to hang, which is what I'm going to do, have a bigger board, or if you only need a small one, they come in that size. I've already made three parts of a frame, very simply. It's made from 50 by 25 pine. You can buy that in the right sort of length. You might need to trim it to length, and it fits in there. But of course, you don't nail it in that way. Turn it over, because you always nail from the thin piece of material to the thick piece. Well, this board is all right so far for putting the hooks in on which I'm going to hang the larger tools. But for things like your wood glue and your little packet of panel pins and pencils, you need a shelf. So I propose to add a shelf to the bottom of this. The shelf is made of a piece of 100 by 13 anything, timber or board, and a piece of 50 by 13, fixed together in an L section, glued and panel pinned together. There it is. I usually put the panel pins part the way in first because it makes it easier to fix when you're slipping around on glue. Well, that's it. You can paint it and plane it and sand it and make it as fancy as you like, but as far as I'm concerned, it's a utility shadow board and that'll do for me. Pine panel is another man-made board with which we're becoming increasingly familiar. You'll probably recognise it in shelving of this type. The beauty of it is it's now available in several widths and lengths up to 2400 millimetres, which means that should you want to increase the number of shelves or replace a broken one or one that's got lost, you simply go to your hardware store and you choose the appropriate size and width, cut it to length if necessary, and slot it in. Like that. Or, if you're feeling really energetic, you can do what I did and custom design and build your own. This occasional table is made from another man-made board called Fibrom. It comes in sheets of varying widths like this. This is the material. It's really beautiful. It's lovely and smooth. It cuts smoothly. It drills smoothly. And it's so easy to paint compared with particle board. And it's probably just a couple of dollars more. I've cut another set of this, so I want to show you how it all goes together. Because Fibron is so easy to machine, you can actually dowel the parts together without having to nail, and that means there are no nails showing and it's all lovely, clean, secret fixing. So I've already put the dowels into the legs and now I'm going to fix the rail. Drop some adhesive into the holes in the rail and push that over the dowels already set into the side. You do the same for each piece, dowels in the holes with some adhesive, and then fix the bottom shelf into place. Having done that, just gently tap the pieces down with your hand before hammering them in. Then put some adhesive in the holes in the rail and the shelf and some across the face. Once that's done, pick up the other leg piece and place it on top. Locate the dowels in the leg piece into the holes and tap it down gently with your hand. Then take a block of wood, a small block of wood like this, and bit by bit until it all goes down. Turn it over and tap the other side in to make sure it's all nicely closed up. All right. Turn it top side up and the holes are drilled for the dowels. Put some glue in the holes again, all points of contact. And then hammer the dowels in and put the top on. The boards that we've looked at so far are all made for special purposes, but they have a range of uses. And if you're not sure which board you want for the job you're going to do, have a look at this chart which is on display in your hardware store and it will tell you exactly what you can do with the type of board you choose. Good luck.
If you live on an island like that, you wouldn't have to worry about filling in forms like all of these. But the fact of life is that if we want the good things such as roads, hospitals and schools, taxes have to pay for them. Now, even though the word tax terrifies most people, if you take the time to know what you're doing, it's not that difficult. First, what are the deadlines for putting in your tax returns? For most people, it's October 31st. And if you use an accountant or a tax agent, they can get an extension of time for you until next year. What are your main responsibilities when filling in your tax return? The main thing is to make sure you include all taxable income from all sources. And remember, the tax department does not now check your tax return in most cases. It may be 4 or 5 years before you're picked out for an audit. Then if you made a mistake, it can bounce back on you very hard later. Where can you go to get the information you need about filling in your tax form? The basic tool you'll need is TaxPack, which by now you should have. But don't forget, if there's other specific things, there are a lot of pamphlets available from the tax department. So if you need information, don't be frightened to ask for it. The pamphlets are free. If you've found you've made a mistake in your tax return after your form has gone in, let your accountant or the tax department know as soon as possible. If you tell them you've made a mistake, they'll take a lenient view, but if they catch you out, there may be heavy fines. When should you do your own tax return? It's okay doing it yourself if you're happy with TaxPack, if your affairs aren't complicated and you know what you can claim. When shouldn't you do it? If there's income from many sources, if your affairs are complicated or you aren't sure about your tax deductions. Let me say one thing. If you're in any doubt at all, consult a tax agent or an accountant. How do you know what deductions you can claim and how do you prepare for them? Now, they're all set out in TaxPack and they include such things as superannuation in certain cases, tour allowances and union fees. However, if you aren't sure, ask a tax agent or your accountant. If you've been disorganised this year, resolve to be different next year and keep records of all your expenses. In need, put them all in a shoebox, but make sure you've got them by June 30th of next year. There you are. That's the simple way to handle income tax. Next week, we'll talk about ways you can cut down your tax bill. See you then.
Next up, the latest inventions and gadgets for you and your home, and Normie Rowe hits the roof. Before Normie Rowe looks at ladders that take you to dark places, most of you will recall the highly successful ABC TV program, The Inventors. Well, the newest member of the Bricks and Mortar team is Bev Gledhill, and Bev's one of the brains behind The Inventors, and since then, she's been specialising in investigating the latest breakthroughs in products and gadgets which make our lives easier. Bev, welcome to the Bricks and Mortar team.
It's great to be here, Catherine. It really is.
Well, tell me how you got involved in gadgets in the first place.
Well, the problem is, you see, inventors need someone to help them. They're great at inventing things, but they're not very good at selling the idea. The man who invented the zip actually took 30 years from the time he invented it till he actually got it onto the market. So, you see, I think it's my mission in life to maybe promote some of these things and help the inventors.
Do you actually go out seeking the gadgets, or do you find now that they come to you?
I used to go out looking for them, but these days the letterbox is always full and the phone's always ringing.
So, well, what are we going to be looking at on our show?
Well, the sort of things that make life easier, you know, in the kitchen, in the garden, in the bathroom, just general things that everyone really needs. Look, we've been doing a few of them. Have a look at this one.
Ugh. You know, there's nothing worse than going to the fridge and taking out what you thought were fresh vegetables and finding something like that. These beans have actually only been in the fridge for a week and a half, would you believe it? And they smell revolting. But there's no problem. There's a new product that's come out, which is a green polyethylene bag. Now, these carrots have been in this bag for 3 weeks. Look at that, isn't it fantastic? And the reason they're so fresh is because the polyethylene actually absorbs ethylene gas, which is given off when fruit and vegetables keep breathing. Now, you know, if you cut the top of a carrot off, it'll actually grow, so they're still alive, even though they're out of the ground. That celery's been in there for a week and a half, not quite as long as the carrots, but still very fresh. And that's a three-week lettuce. Look, it's really crunchy. The secret in this green plastic is that there's a volcanic rock which is crushed up and put into the polyethylene, and this is the thing that absorbs the gas that turns the things bad. It was originally developed so that the guys going to the Antarctic could have fresh fruit and vegetables with them. Now, these bags come in three sizes. There's a small, medium and large one. This is a medium one. Takes most things. That's the one I put my carrots into. You can buy them in supermarkets, and they cost about $3 for a bag of 10. But you can reuse them. All you have to do is just dry them out and pop your things back in. The beaut thing about it is that you can buy things when they're on special, stock them away in the fridge, 3-5 weeks later, you've got things like this carrot. Terrific. Do you know that in a city with 1 million homes, if 1 in 4 used 100 mils of oil, that's about half a cup, every day, and all those people tipped that oil when they'd finished it down the sink, that'd be 35,700 bottles of oil that'd be going down the sewers and out into the ocean every day. That's a terrible thought. But now we can actually do something about it. There's a product called Temple, and it's actually made from castor oil. That's pretty awful, I know. It looks a bit like Lux Flakes. Now, if you put, say, 3 teaspoons, into a bowl for every half cup of oil, when you finish cooking, put the hot oil on top and just let it melt, As it gets cool, after it gets past, say, 40 degrees Celsius, it'll start to get thick. And as soon as it's cool, it'll solidify, just like that. And once you've got it like that, of course, you can just scrape it out into some paper, wrap it up, and throw it away in the garbage. It's all biodegradable. Great idea.
Beautiful, isn't it? You know, for 20 years, I've been looking for somewhere to stick this. It was a 21st birthday present from one of my aunts. I want to find a place that I can put it where it's not too hard to get to, you know, just in case. And I think I've found the spot. Somewhere that I can put this and a lot of my other junk. Sorry, Auntie.
So this is the answer, Alan.
Yes, indeed. This leads to inner space.
What are the benefits of installing an attic ladder?
Well, the real benefit is to get use of the space up there for storage. Lots of things in cupboards and around the room, house, that you can really get away. Suitcases, toys.
Can they be installed in any home?
Yes, they can, so long as there's sufficient height within the space there, 4 feet, let's say, you should be able to install a ladder, and so long as it's not a flat roof, of course.
You said you should be able to install it. Could I install one of these?
Of course you can, yes. The average handyman can install an attic ladder.
When you're installing this, what precautions should you take?
Well, you need to look, first of all, within the space up there to see that there are no wires, no pipes, or maybe hanging beams, if you're familiar with that term, that links all the ceiling joists together, as long as they're not in the way.
Are they all standard sizes, or can they be made to measure?
Well, actually, ladders are made according to the floor-to-ceiling height, so there's usually one that will fit the range.
And what are the standard sizes?
Well, they go between the standard ceiling of today, which is about 2.4 metres, up to 3.66.
What styles are available?
The styles available are either timber or aluminium.
They look pretty expensive. How much are they to install?
Well, the ladders themselves, according again to their floor-to-ceiling height, range between $425 up to, and I'm talking about domestic ladders now, $625.
It's not a lot of money for all that extra storage space, is it?
No, it isn't.
Okay, so how do they operate?
Would you like me to show you?
Would you mind?
Indeed. Well, first of all, to lift the ladder, you hold the panel back and just lift underneath the centre section. A spring on the side here will help to lift the lower section into position, and then you just allow it to go back. The next thing is to keep firm grip always on the panel because it is spring-loaded. Engage the stick.
Oh, well, that's really good, but can you actually get locked in there? I mean, can somebody down here close it up and leave you in the ceiling?
Well, for safety reasons, that should never happen, but someone, if they did lock you in, you could get out all right in an emergency.
That's really good because I've got kids. Be a minute, Auntie.
That'll teach him. Next, recycled rubbish, which helps the home renovator, and we might put your street on the map. Some people spend thousands of dollars renovating Federation houses. But sometimes, however, these houses have to be torn down for lots of reasons, like safety. Harry Tikalis, however, is someone who makes sure that the beauty of these houses is not reduced to rubble. Harry, I've heard of demolition, of course, but just what is deconstruction?
Right. Basically, what we do is we dismantle the buildings. Instead of just getting the big bulldozers in and excavators, we actually employ carpenters and experienced labourers, and we just get into their properties and we actually take everything apart. We remove all items like, for example, the tiles, the timber, the windows, doors, floorboards, skirting boards, architraves.
So there's a big demand?
Because of the recession, we've been very busy, and to maintain the environment, just gets good benefit because all this material, it just doesn't end up at the dump. Where we used to get about 15 loads of rubbish out of a normal house, now we get about 2 loads. What we've done is we actually went to the building sites and we picked up everything that was there. And we thought that we get everything to the yard, and when we see what sort of demand we'll get for each individual item. Nearly 90% of the materials that you find into a house, we do pick them and bring them down here, and they do sell very well.
So what are some of the things that you've got here then?
Well, the basic stock we've got is the timber, and we've got windows, doors, roof tiles, bricks, floorboards.
I noticed that you've got some old suitcases, little jars and things like that. Do they sell as well?
Oh, yes. Yes, they do sell. And it's funny, but those items, we usually found them underneath floors when we...
The kinds of things that people forget that they put them away.
That's
they've
right.
stored them and they forget
that's
them.
That's right, yes.
So they've got a new life as well.
Yeah.
So, Harry, who comes here to buy?
The majority of our customers are people that they renovate or doing extensions.
Well, we've discovered that deconstruction combines not only demolition, but the recognition that just about everything in a house can be recycled. And in doing that, we're not only preserving our heritage, but we're also doing a little bit more to protect the environment. Here at Bricks and Mortar, we want you to put your street on the map. So each week we pick 6 streets from suburbs all around Australia. If we call out your street, then drop us a line and post it free in the Bricks and Mortar mailbox at your local BBC hardware store. The first entries received from each street will win the prize pack of books valued at $150 with the compliments of Doubleday, including Bob Ryan's helpful guide. So, fingers crossed. This week's